Hello, citizens of the webs, and welcome to WatchGuard Security Week in Review, a video podcast dedicated to quickly summarizing the biggest information and network security stories each week and to sharing practical information security tips along the way. I'm your host and security geek, Corey Nachreiner, and this is the episode for the week starting March 9th, 2015. Let's jump right in and cover this week's Daily Bytes. Today's story is Apple Patch Day. Apple released 4 security bulletins fixing flaws in some of their most popular products, including OS X, iOS, Apple TV, and Xcode, which is their development platform. If you're an Apple user, you surely at least use iOS or OS X. And the updates for those products fix a couple of security flaws, including many serious ones, but the one you're probably most aware of is last week I was talking about the freak SSL vulnerability, the thing that made it easier for bad guys to man-in-the-middle SSL. Well, the iOS and OS X updates fix that flaw, so you no longer have to worry about people sniffing on your SSL connections. If you're an Apple user, be sure to get those updates. While I'm talking about updates, don't forget tomorrow is Microsoft Patch Day, so you can expect me to talk about that on Tuesday. Today's news is Microsoft's March Patch Day. If you're in information security, you know the drill. The second Tuesday of the month is Patch Day, and this month's Patch Day is pretty humongous, with 14 security bulletins, 5 of which are rated as critical and the rest as important. There's way too many different updates to go into, but generally the updates fix flaws in Windows, Internet Explorer, Office Components, the Exchange Server, and VBScript. Let me give you the big highlights. First of all, remember Freak? You probably do because I've been talking about it a lot. Well, the good news is this month Microsoft fixed it for Windows, so you can fix that SSL man-in-the-middle flaw. On top of that, do you remember Stuxnet? This, of course, is the big, sophisticated nation-state malware that came in 2010. Well, Stuxnet was known for using 4 different zero-day vulnerabilities, including one flaw that involved link files, which are shortcut files in Windows. And Stuxnet used this link vulnerability to pass over USB storage devices. Well, everyone believed that Microsoft fixed that zero-day vulnerability way back in 2010. It turns out the flaw wasn't completely fixed, and one of the updates today, specifically MS-15020, does complete that old Stuxnet fix. Besides those two big highlights, there were plenty of other critical vulnerabilities, the traditional cumulative Internet Explorer patch, which fixes lots of vulnerabilities bad guys can use in drive-by download attacks. On top of that, Exchange server administrators should know about the important Exchange update. Among other things, it fixes 4 cross-site scripting vulnerabilities. If a bad guy can get one of your Outlook web access users to click a link, he can essentially gain access to that Outlook web access user's account. Anyways, those are just some Microsoft Patch Day highlights. If you want more information, be sure to check out our blog post on the subject. By the way, good news for some of you WatchGuard users out there, we also released a whole bunch of IPS signatures to protect you from many of the vulnerabilities disclosed today. So even though I recommend you patch them as soon as you can, our IPS will help close the vulnerability window if it takes you a while to test and deploy all these updates. And today I want to talk about almost science fiction, a sophisticated attack that affects physical computer memory called Rowhammer. Now, this attack was posted to Google's Project Zero by other Google researchers, and it's based on research from many other organizations as well. Here it is in a nutshell. Basically, researchers found that DRAM memory, or dynamic random access memory, suffers from an issue. Now, the chips are so small and the transistors are so close that if you actually repeatedly access the memory location on a particular a transistor, or you hammer that particular transistor, there's a chance that the electromagnetic charge associated with that can leak over to another transistor and can actually flip a bit, which means it will change a 1 to a 0 in a different part of memory, causing a classic memory corruption. Now, this new Google research also showed how bad guys might take advantage of that. Basically, by strategically doing this hammering attack at a very particular part of memory, these researchers might have a chance of flipping a bit in the page table entries. And without going in all the detail, basically the page table is what controls the addressing for all your physical memory. So if a bad guy can control write access to the page table, there's a chance he can do read-write access to your entire memory, which essentially means he can run whatever he wants and have control of your computer. So this is a pretty fascinating attack. It's rare that actual physics of electricity result in these sorts of computer attacks. Now, while this is really a fascinating attack, you really don't have to worry about it in the practical world today. I don't think cyber criminals are going to pull this into their toolbox anytime soon. While the researchers were able to actually create a proof of concept attack on some Linux equipment, they found that many of the memory chips they tried did not succumb to the attack. There's even some chips that can actually correct errors. So if a one gets flipped to a zero or vice versa, it will fix it. Nonetheless, it really is a very, very interesting attack, and it really shows you how deep secure design can go. It's all the way down to the design of the electrical equipment you use in your computing systems. And today I want to talk about some new ransomware that's targeting gamers, especially since I'm a gamer myself. It's called TrueCrypt, and you can learn about it on a post from Bleeping Computer or from some research from the Bromium research team. Essentially, you know what ransomware is. This is the class of malware that makes your computer unusable and then extorts you for money to get it back. The latest type of ransomware that's really popular right now is called crypto ransomware because it specifically encrypts important files on your computer and you have to pay to get them decrypted. And of course, CryptoLocker was the really popular variant of ransomware that cost a lot of users a lot of money and really popularized this type of ransomware. In the past, crypto ransomware tended to target business files, things like documents, source code, maybe things like images and videos. But TrueCrypt is the first ransomware that really targets gamers. This particular ransomware can recognize the save games, the profiles, the maps, the mods, and all the additional customized files associated with the most popular 20 games, games like Call of Duty or Minecraft or Skyrim or Diablo and many other popular games. Once it encrypts your files, TrueCrypt is a lot like other ransomware out there. It will pop up a screen telling you you have 3 days to pay the ransom. The ransom is about 2 Bitcoin or $500. It is a little unusual in these bad guys try to get you to connect to a Tor network. They're trying to anonymize their ransom or extortion server for you to make payments. And they, of course, accept payments in Bitcoin or in PayPal cash cards, I believe, as well. Anyways, I'm not sure how successful this particular malware will be. While things like CryptoWall and CryptoLocker were and still are very successful, they tend to target business users. You know, things like documents and CAD files are very important files that adults use and make money from. This particular ransomware seems to be bringing down the age of the victim. While there are older folks like me that play video games, you know, this will make ransomware affect some of the files that a younger age group may be interested in. Now, on the flip side, younger people may not have as much income to pay for this, so I'm not sure why the attackers are targeting gamers in this way. In any case, if you are a gamer, it is a very interesting new piece of ransomware to be aware of. If you use antivirus, it will detect some of these threats, and I especially recommend any sort of behavioral virus detection, like WatchGuard's APT blocker, to ensure you never miss even the latest zero-day malware that comes out. There's so much news I could cover today. A USB device that's frying computers, the fact that there's a new Adobe Flash update, which you should definitely go get, or the fact that the US Congress is quietly trying to pass the Cybersecurity Information Sharing Act, which could have privacy implications. But instead, I'm going to warn you that Jamie Oliver's site has been hacked yet again. You probably remember a few weeks ago, the popular chef Jamie Oliver had his website hijacked and bad guys injected code that forced the visitors of the site to get a drive-by download if they haven't patched. That same thing has happened yet again. Even though the webmasters cleaned up the original attack, they may not have actually found out how the attacker got in. You know, the attacker may have leveraged a web application flaw to get access, or maybe they have control of the CMS system the website uses, but in either case, attackers have injected more malicious JavaScript on Jamie Oliver's website. And this, of course, was discovered by some researchers at Fox IT. So what should you do about this? Well, I recommend you try to avoid Jamie Oliver's site right now. While the webmasters say they've cleaned up this new script, who knows if they found the underlying vulnerability, so it could happen again. Meanwhile, as I recommended before, you might try to disable script with plugins like NoScript as you're browsing websites. By the way, if you're a webmaster, this is why you always need to patch your website, use updated plugins, use secure coding practices, and if all else fails, make sure to use a web application firewall. Web application flaws are very, very dangerous, so if you don't have a securely coded website, this could happen to you as well.
That's all, folks. Hope you enjoyed this week's episode. As always, I have a blog post associated with this video where you can read all kinds of other news stories that I post in the reference section. And be sure to subscribe to that blog. It's blog.watchguard.com or watchguardsecuritycenter.com, whichever you prefer. You can also follow me on Twitter. I'm at SecAdept, or follow WatchGuard at WatchGuardTech. Finally, be sure to subscribe to my YouTube channel as well if you want the videos quickly. Anyways, thank you for watching, and here at WatchGuard, we're rooting for you.